Hello and welcome. We're glad you decided to join us today by downloading and listening to this week's featured message. We pray that you allow God to use this week's message to teach and inspire you while you listen.
Think of our forefathers and their plight, and how the music of Scripture saw them through. Thank you, Quartet, for reminding us that even in the midst of terrible situations, a person can build a highway to heaven by singing about the name of Jesus. Will you marry me? That is my subject today. Let us pray. Father, once again, as I have done so many times, I commend myself to you and for your usage in the Word. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Will you marry me? That's what I hear, Mama Lee, when I read the third commandment. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Will you marry me? In number 626, Claudette read it. Elder Haynes read it. He says, I will put my name on my people. I cannot stress enough to you that these first four commandments are joined together. And it has thrilled me, Doug, to be able to present these first four in a chain so you can see their connection. For when we are finished, next Sabbath, I will preach my first sermon on the fourth commandment. And I will simply preach on the subject, remember. But the word remember, Derek, as presented in that Hebrew, is actually the word of a lover. You know, when marriages get in trouble, it's good to remember. Come on, somebody. And you'll see the Sabbath in a whole different light next week. See, recall, at an Ezekiel, the Sabbath is called the wedding band. You show up next week. So these first four commandments, Cheryl, are very relational. It is a God who is feeling, come on somebody, it's a God who is feeling unloved by his bride. Don't put somebody before me. Don't try to remake me. When you take on my name, don't do so indifferently. And then, when the marriage gets in trouble, remember. Oh, shoot, y'all. And so today I just want to feast on the third commandment. Now, I'm not going to go through, team, all that stuff I gave you that we've already learned. They got that now. Let's start with the section on what we've learned on the first commandment. Give that to me, Bob. What we've learned from the first commandment. Give that to me. Ah, yes. These are the things now we've learned in the commandments we've preached thus far. Are you with me? Downstairs? All right. Let's read. No other gods exist but Creator God, known as Yahweh. That's what we got. See, in other words, there's only one husband. God brokes no rivals. Then we learned from that same commandment, read, nothing else should be looked to before you look to God. God says, I want to be the man in your life. Look to me. Come on, Jesus. Look to me. Don't look around here and yonder. Look to you. You're mine. I can handle it. What else did we learn from that first commandment? Read. Once you look to God for help, God does not need any assistance. We have a lover who can take care of business. I guess I have to celebrate by myself. We have a God who's able. Then. Second commandment. See, Pastor has to calm down. Second commandment. Here we go. The main sin is not replacing God, but trying to remake God. Now, I don't want you to forget that. The second commandment is saying, look, I'm all you need the way I am, and don't try to remake me. See, that's the problem with so many marriages. People are trying to remake their spouses. See, I just stuck that in. That's bonus stuff. It's not in the notes at all. Just brought it up. Nothing here about that in my sermon. Just hit me. All right. Let's keep going. What else have we learned? Second commandment. Read. Loving God involves accepting the way He reveals Himself to us. See, the reason why some of you are having trouble in your marriages, you're still trying to get your lover to love your way. Accept the love the person gives their way. If you want it to be married to you, so God is saying, I, this is the way I love. Accept my love as I present it. It's a good sermon so far, isn't it? Then the third thing from this second commandment, come on. A misconception of God has led mankind to a cycle of decline. See, the first challenge to a marriage is unfulfilled expectations. You marry with this picture of how things are going to be. They ain't going to be that way. How many of you know I'm telling the truth? Oh, no, take it easy now. Calm down. Don't get anything stirred up around here. But you know, wasn't that the truth? That's the truth, see? And then feelings decline because you had these unrealistic expectations. Not going to be fulfilled. Now love cools down. All right. Then we learned something else from the second commandment. Here it is. God, read it. God had given us an image of Himself. It is Jesus. Remember that part of the sermon? That was good stuff. God said, don't make any graven images. I've made an image. It's me in Jesus. He declares me. So these are things that we have learned so far. Now, last week as I preached on the second part of the second commandment, I keep trying to establish in your minds the conceptual link of the first four commandments. All of them are in that part of the law that's love to God. Love to who? Let's build on that. As we move to the third commandment, we are still in this whole context of a right attitude toward God. Now, I'm going to shift gears on you. But included in these first two commandments is a hint of God's attitude toward us. So you recall in the second commandment, God begins to bring this marriage image in. He says, "For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God." Jealous God. And then I read that quote from the book Patriarchs and Prophets, which says, "The close and sacred relation of God to his people is represented under the figure of what? Marriage. Marriage. So this marriage idea is not something I've conjured up to entertain you. This is how God feels about his relationship with us. It's like a marriage. But these first four commandments are about much more than obeying God. They're about loving God. And he's trying to develop with us a love akin to lovers. You see, the Bible is very clear that God's attitude toward us is one of possessiveness. But it's a positive sense. God wants you so bad. Oh my goodness. He wants us so bad that he just keeps extending himself. You've never been loved like you're loved by God. Never. You never will be loved like you're loved by God. Keeps extending himself. He's an awesome lover. Somebody ought to give God a good amen. So here comes the third. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. There's two words I'm going to deal with. Take and in vain. What does it mean to take the name of the Lord? The Hebrew word is lakah. Say it. Speaking in tongues now. Say it again. Lakah. Speaking in tongues. Lakah. Now, look at the meanings. Come on. It means what? To fetch. Go ahead. To seize. To acquire, bring, snatch. Thou shalt not get married to the Lord in vain. When you, Denisha, were baptized and took on the name of Jesus, you said yes to his proposal. And he declares now, with no hesitation, if you're going to marry me, don't take my name. I ain't ready to deal with in vain yet. But don't take, when you say yes to me, you take on my name in the same sense as an ancient wife. And only the book of Exodus uses that form of the word. And it's the form that has to do like a Western woman who, when she takes on a man or he takes her on, she takes on his name. Mrs. And we are the bride of the church. We are Mrs. Christ. Thou shalt not take my name on in vain. Therefore, we should act like and talk like and walk like and eat like and dress like and worship like we are married to the man Christ Jesus. Come on, somebody. See, there's a complaint registered by God against his people in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 4:1. This is one of the strangest texts in the Bible. Read this stuff. Come on. And in that day, I need to hear you. Downstairs, let's go. And in that day, seven women saying, "We will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name to take away our reproach." See, the holy book represents bread as teachings. And in the holy book, apparel means lifestyle. Seven is the number of completeness. So the text is saying that the half-stepping, half-loving church is saying to Jesus, we want your name. We want to be called Mrs. Christ. It looks better, Jesus, but we will eat our own bread. That is, we'll teach our own teachings. And we'll wear our own clothes. We'll have our own lifestyle. But to keep us from looking like the sorry Christians we are, at least let us wear your name. And you must ask yourself today, what kind of disgrace do you bring to Jesus Christ wearing his name? And we get offended if somebody suggests we're not Christian. Offended if somebody hints we're not what we ought to be. But God is saying, I'm tired of people taking on my name, but then taking the Bible and twisting it to their own style, manufacturing their own teachings, but they want to be called Christian. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God, how? In vain. See, let's go back to Christ's first attempts to really hook up with this church. Exodus 19, 9 through 12. Exodus 19, 9 through 12. See, once you accept, I'm going to now deal with this, I'm setting up for the in vainness. In vain. You've got his name, but in vain. In vain. Exodus 19, 9 through 12. You see it? Let's read. And they said, everybody, and they said what? Stand back. Oh, I'm sorry. Exodus 19. It's hard to read in Exodus when you're in Genesis. Exodus 19. Difficult thing to pull off. I tried, but I couldn't. I just couldn't do it. Yeah, I need to get an Exodus where you are. Yeah. Exodus 19:9. Ready? Let's read. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. Verse 10. And the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today. And tomorrow let them wash their clothes. What's going on here? Verse 11. And be ready against the third day. For the third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Now if you read this in Hebrew, it's actually marriage language. The Lord's going to say, I'm getting ready to come and be introduced to my bride. Verse 12, read. And thou shalt set bounds unto the people round about. Everybody's saying, take heed to yourselves. That you go not up into the mount or touch the border of it. Whosoever touches the mount shall be surely put to death. Now, wait a minute. What kind of wedding invitation is this? Look at verse 16. Read. There were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mount, and the voice of the trumpet exceeding loud, so that all the people that was in the camp trembled. There's you got to get the dynamics. Will you marry me? He wants to have this relationship. Let me tell you one thing that can happen in a marriage. Get married. Say, I do. Set up house. Start living together. You can get used to one another. Now, the married folks are hesitant to say amen because they're sitting next to their spouse. Get used to one another. You know, in the early days, you know how we are in the early days, Brother Branch. Why? The person is so special. Even the way you talk to them, the way you approach them, so special. Tone of voice. You watch your tone of voice. Because they're special. Even the way we hold their hand and put our arm around them. Caring manner. It's the early days. And they are so special. You're joining me in this. You're joining me in this. See, they're with me. Special, special. It's the early days. Early days. And when we're around them, we perfume ourselves up. Cologne ourselves up. Come on, somebody. Or look in the mirror several times. Make sure everything's in place. Because the person we're about to go out with is special. 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 And so the Lord says to the people, he says, now look, look. He said, you can't even see my face. And no man shall see me and live. He's announcing to them. See, don't read the fear in this. He's saying, I'm special. And what you don't want to do, church, is forget how special I am and get into the marriage and start treating this one and only God like an ordinary God. Because the God we serve is special. Somebody ought to say amen. And a danger in a marriage is reaching that point where you forgot that that person you married was special. Want to make love and stuff? Ain't put nothing on. Ain't washed, let alone perfume. How come y'all sitting so quiet in this place here? Pastor's preaching on the facts of life. When you used to take them out, you'd dress all up, put some on. Now you got on your jeans and old sloppy shoes going out somewhere. What happened to special? And so when God first, I'm going somewhere with this, I'm not entertaining you. When God first introduces himself, he's letting them know, look, the God, your lover, is special. He's not ordinary, and so you need to be careful, because it's not that God wants them to be intimidated or trepidatious, but there's something being stirred by the third commandment, and God is saying, when you take on my name, do not start taking me for granted, take me lightly, because your marriage to me does not give you the right to wifely irreverence. Isaiah 14. Isaiah 14. Isaiah wants to talk now. And he tells us what happened to one who was close to God. And what I'm preaching on now, Nadine, is God has married you, but your closeness to him does not give you the right to treat him as an ordinary person. He's God all by himself. He's God all the time. He's special always. He's special always. Look what happened. Isaiah 14. You see it? 12 through 14. I need you downstairs with me in the balcony as well. Let's read verse 12, Isaiah 14, everybody. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did... Verse 13, everybody, for thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. Wait a minute. I will exalt my throne above the... What is this? Sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will... Now, we've studied this passage many times, Keith Bramble, in various ways. But today I want you to see this passage in the light of the issues presented to us by the words of the third commandment. Satan, listen to me, Don Powell. Satan, listen to me, church. Satan began to feel that proximity to God and familiarity with God gave him the right to disrespect God. He was so close to God that he sat by a throne. Only two were above him, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. In fact, Ellen White says he was second in heaven because Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are one. And yet, God is saying, in spite of the fact, devil, that you're that close, you have no right to treat me any old way. Marriage is a close relationship. You better stay with me today. But never should it lead to the kind of familiarity that would cause one spouse to feel that they can treat the other with rampant disrespect. You ain't never been that close. And so Satan's attitude toward God is no different really here than the believer, particularly the long-time believer who comes to church on Sabbath, stands out in the lobby of the church while service is ongoing, talking loud, and maybe even carrying on sacred conversation out there in the lobby on God's sacred day in God's holy house. You ain't never got so close to Jesus you got a right to do that. Satan's attitude toward God is no different than the member who comes on in the sanctuary, sits during the meditation music in God's holy house on God's holy day, chatting leisurely about whatever until service starts, and does not spend one time meditating during meditation. Has that member assumed that their proximity to God allows them to take God's presence lightly? Or for that matter, what about the member who turns the lobby of the church into a picnic table and eats food, chews gum, and drops crumbs from the sanctuary to the kitchen? Has this member no regard for the fact that though holy angels live in the proximity of God, they veil their faces at his presence? How dare we ever think we've reached the point in this church where God's presence can be treated like somebody standing on the corner? When you walk in this place, God is here. Your marriage to God does not give you the right to treat his place like your living room. What happened to the day when church members walked in church silent and gilded with reverence, recognizing that this rostrum is holy and this place is holy, and children don't run up and down in here, up and down this church, and carry chewing gum and candy through God's halls? What gave us the right to think that we're so buddy-buddy with God, we've been married to him so long, that his holy presence no longer has value to God's people? When did we get to be so close to God? When did we gain such privileges? What are we teaching our children about the sanctity of the presence of God? He decries with pain in his voice, "Will you marry me? Don't take my name in vain." You remember Isaiah 6, 1 through 5. It talks there about how the seraphim veiled their faces. Review and Herald says the seraphim before the throne are so filled with reverential awe and beholding the glory of God that they do not for an instant look upon themselves with self-complacency. Folk, we must cease the complacency that we have in this church about God's presence. And the reason why we can sit in church during the meditation time and talk and whisper is because we have no consciousness that we're right in God's face. The ancient Hebrews were conscious that the holy temple was where God dwelled. We've come to the point where we act like we're doing God a favor to show up. And that's why next week when I talk about remember, he's going to call you back to when you first met him, when you were in awe of him. You know how it is in the first marriage? You know, when you first get married. Oh, I just love talking to her. Oh, I just love listening to him. Oh, his presence just makes me feel better. What happens to that? Maybe it's the same thing that happens to us in church. We just walk in. It's just the sanctuary. You ever study the meaning of the word sanctuary? Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. David was so awed by the presence of God, Frank Baker, in the sanctuary, he wrote in Psalm 89:7 these words. Listen, God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him. The presence of the Lord. You see, the words of the third commandment are fat with truth. Let's go now to the phrase, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. In what? in vain. What's this issue about the name? Well, you know how it is, how we are when you first get married. And you remind people, if they call you Miss, you remind them, you know, Mrs. Mrs. Fella, Mrs. And you're sending a message. You're sending a message that the status has changed. The status has changed. In the Bible, God's name is a big deal. Do you know that ancient Hebrews would not even say his name? See, the word Jehovah came into being because they wouldn't say Yahweh. Yahweh is his name, I am. And this name, I am, not I was, not I will. I am the constantly self-existing one by whom all things present and past exist. And when the Lord descended in the cloud to talk to Moses, he proclaimed the name of the Lord. The name of the Lord in the Bible is a big deal. Well, the commentary clears it up, Carol. It says the name of God represents his character. His character. His character. So that's why Christians should never marry non-Christians. Believers should not marry non-believers. Because you take on the person's character. And if their character is not in Christ, what in the world are you taking on? So it represents his character. Now, if his name represents his character, then you become not just Christ's soulmate, you grow to be more like him. See, when God speaks about being jealous, he is bending us toward this marriage analogy. And I looked up this word in vain. It's the word shaw. What is it? What is it? Speaking in tongues again. It means emptiness, vanity, falsehood, in vain. A little translation is, you shall not take the name of the Lord, or you shall not marry the Lord and treat him as if he's empty. How does this apply to the third commandment? They used to make idols of wood and stone and metal. Remember that? When they got in trouble, what could that idol do? What could the idol do? Nothing. So the Bible is saying, when you take the name of the Lord as empty, you are saying you have married a do-nothing husband. Y'all still with me? He said, don't treat me as a do-nothing. So when you marry God, I'm going right back to the first commandment. When you marry God, he's saying, treat me as the somebody in your life. As the one who can do, the one that can come through. Look to me first. Believe in me. I feel sorry for a person, listen to me, I feel sorry for a person who gets married and then loses faith in their spouse. But hallelujah, Jesus, he is declaring, when you marry me, you won't come up empty. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. When you marry me, what you need, I can supply. What you don't have, I am. Don't take on my name, don't marry me, and then treat me like a nobody because I can do everything that you need to be done. And that's why the commandment covers profanity. Because when you take God's name and use it in a profane way, you are saying he is nothing. When two people marry, been married a good while. Long time. They begin to take on each other's traits. Have you noticed that? Yeah. And that's why you got to be sure who you marry. Because if you stay around them long enough, you don't take on their. No, you'll say to folk, oh, it looked like brother and sister. People say, look like brother and sister. Well, they've been married 40 years. Stay with me. I'm going somewhere with this. Take on one another's traits. There's a crossover. There's a what? There's a crossover. And Glenn, I got to studying that thing. And it fits the marriage of Jesus to the church. He says, I want you to take on me. But to show you my commitment, before you take on me, I'm going to take on you. And so Harold Sanford, Desire of Ages, says, oh my Lord, where is it? Where is it? Ha! Ha! Desire of Ages, page 25. Come on, Bob. Read this. Read this. In taking on our nature, the Savior has bound himself to humanity by a... Through the eternal ages, he is linked with us. God gave his only begotten Son to become one of the human family forever. Crossover. Crossover. I'm going to become like them. I want this marriage to work. I don't want a lot of distance between us. And so I'm going to take on who they are forever. Because I want them to take on who I am forever. And so 1 Peter 1:4 says, come on, read. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers. He has become like us, and now we become like him. You ought to say amen. Hallelujah. The change is necessary. Because when Christ married you, you were a dye-in-the-wool, no-good, stomping-down perfectionist of a sinner. But he took on sinful flesh. Took on human nature. Then he says, if I can take on your dirt, surely you can take on my holiness. Hallelujah! 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 Will you marry me? He says, you win in the exchange. I take your mess. You take my victory. You can't beat it, folk. It's the best marriage in the world. So thou shalt not take that on in vain. Has the marriage worked for you? How much more are you like Jesus since you said I do? Is the marriage working? Are you working on a separation? Is divorce in your future? Because like any marriage, you can't make your spouse do nothing. Some of us haven't learned that yet. I took on your stuff. I took on your stuff. I'm waiting on you to take on my stuff. He's meek and lowly. Have you gotten there yet? He's forgiving. Have you gotten there yet? He's pure. Have you gotten there yet? Have you taken on the characteristics of your spouse? Are you wearing his name in vain? There's nothing like the name of Jesus. You hear me? There is nothing like the name of Jesus. And he says, Henry, you can wear my name over there in the book of Zechariah. It paints Joshua the high priest. Remember him standing there? Clothes are raggedy. Represents the character of the human race. And judgment is about to be pronounced, and then suddenly someone is seen coming. It's Jesus. I said it's Jesus. Takes off his robe of righteousness and covers up Joshua. Remember that? You should read it in the Hebrew. Actually, what he does, Carlson, he takes off his name. He takes off his name. See, Revelation tells you that he's going to give you a new name. So in the Hebrew, he takes off. See, his name is a life-changing power. It's a life-changing power. He takes off his name. He drops his name on Joshua. So, when Joshua stands before the Lord, the Lord does not see Joshua. He sees Jesus because he's wearing his name. Join them? Want to sing it with them this week? I was thinking, as I was sitting there, of this thing of exchange. I'm a melancholic choleric. I married a phlegmatic sanguine, my precious wife. Talking about exchange. Now, she married a real idiot. Energetic, boisterous, go get 'em. Take on the world. That's me. Often speak before I really think it through. Ain't that way now, though. Don't mess with me. I think before I speak now. It's been interesting over the years to watch how we've crossed over. Some of y'all would know me at home. I'm just calm, laid back. Don't hardly say anything. Sister Wright has become more forceful. Crossover. The exchange of strengths and qualities has made us a stronger couple. Are you listening to me? That's what Jesus wants. He said, I took you on. Why won't you take me on? Take my name. Wear it. Sweetest name in the world, Isidore. So let's sing that name with them. Don't they sound good? Lead us through it now. Same thing you just sang. And everybody join in. And let's just celebrate the name of Jesus. time, let me hear some soprano, some alto, some tenor, and some bass. Some bass. Everybody now, come on now. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hear you downstairs.
Master,
Master, Savior. Sing his name. Marry me. It's Jesus talking now. Will you take my name? I think the first thing we got to do, Will, is rededicate ourselves to the marriage. Yeah, we got to rededicate ourselves, Jermaine, to the marriage, to Jesus. He offers his name. We said yes. But some of us are living in a state of separation. Some of us are working on divorce from the lover Jesus. And you know you are. And so being thankful for what Jesus is willing to do. He took on your stuff. Got to get somebody to raise their hand today and say, Lord, thank you for inviting me in the marriage. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, get it up, keep it up, keep it up, keep it up. Now your hand is down. Second appeal. The marriage between you and Christ isn't doing so well. And you know that. You'll have to exhibit a bit more courage right now. I want you to stand. You know the marriage between you and Christ isn't going that well. I want you to stand. 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 God bless you. I see you in the balcony. I see you down here. God bless you. Somebody may be living in a state of separation. Divorce could be imminent because the marriage between you and Christ, you've taken his name, but you have not taken on his character, his fullness. You sure somebody else didn't want to stand in response to that appeal? Downstairs, downstairs. You're in church downstairs. Somebody downstairs ought to be standing. Somebody in the back room somewhere watching TV ought to be standing. Father, you see these. Now, bless them. Help them. Respond to them. You can be seated. You can be seated. You can be seated. Now, someone has never taken on the name. The fullness of his truth and his way. You've never taken on the name, and today you'd like to walk down here and take on the name of Jesus and all that it stands for, the truths that it stands for. Maybe you'll start your premarital counseling called Bible studies, but you'll come today. You'll come today. Is the one who'll do that. Now I need to hear you singing that song again. Who'll come? Who'll come and say yes to Jesus today? You're going to take on his name. you're going to give yourself to Him. You're downstairs, you can come. Praise Him. I want to hear the words now. I want to hear the words. Who'll come? Who'll come? Who'll come? Who will come? Come on, man. I'm walking toward you. Who'll come? Just rise up. Walk down here. Go back to the whole song again. Sing with them, church. Who'll come? Who'll come? Do not resist the appeal of your Savior. If you're downstairs, you ought to come. Balcony, you ought to come.
Questions about the message or would like to contact us with any prayer requests, please use the prayer request tool at the top of the page. We invite you to share this message with someone else and check back next week for another message. Thank you for visiting with us. We pray that you experience the presence of God always with you.